long I've wandered. For too long I've roamed. I've looked for fulfillment but found no home. My heart, my soul grieving. I've struggled with believing, buying into all of this deceiving. And the lies keep pouring in. They told me I'd be okay. If I made enough money at the end of the day, if I got that promotion, if I got that new car, if I got that house with that dog in the yard, I'd be fine. But they lied, 'cause somewhere inside, I'm empty. I need more than what I have, and I'm not even looking for material things. I've had enough of that. I need something deeper. Something realer, something that's more than what I'm feeling, 'cause right now, I'm lost, honestly. I mean, I've heard that Jesus died for me, but what does that even mean? Doesn't everybody die? What makes this man so special? What makes him what I need? What makes his blood more powerful when he bleeds? I want to know.
Understand a little bit of what this thing called faith is about. Maybe you're thinking, but I think I'm into this. I think I believe in this. I think I understand it, but you're wondering, how do I seal the deal? How do I get there? How do I become one of those? What do you have to do? And I think Easter is the perfect time. And we're going to give you a chance to do that in a little while. The other thing I love about Easter is for those folks who, you kind of have both feet on the brakes already here this morning. You're like, no, I just kind of came because the only reason I'm here is because Mom promised me lunch today. Or maybe you're here because, you know, the girl invited you and the girl is cute. And She's like, will you come to church? And you're like, church, yeah, I don't even know what that is, but I'm in. Because the girl's cute. So, or maybe you just got lost on the highway and everybody was pulling in here, so you pulled in here. You got stuck somewhere around the McPhee Bridge and you're like, well, let's go see what it is that's going on. Maybe you're here for that this morning. But either way, you're here, but you're not about to become a Christian, right? You're just here checking things out this morning. I want to thank you. But can I encourage you that for you, Easter really is the best weekend to attend church. Because it's when we talk about the thing that addresses, kind of does an end around most of your objections in regards to Christianity. And here's what I mean by that. I would like, even if you've never considered this before, maybe this thing called faith is not your jam, and maybe you're here and your arms are already crossed on the inside, even though they're not crossed on the outside already. If you're there this morning, I would like to challenge you to become a Christian in spite of the fact that you know some. I mean, in spite of the fact that maybe you're married to one. In spite of the fact that you grew up with a bunch of them. In spite of the fact that you just had a bad church experience. In spite of the fact that we're all hypocrites. In spite of the fact that you had a professor or a teacher at one time, and you used to be kind of a religious person, but then they pulled one card out of your religious deck of cards, your house of cards collapsed, and you've never looked back because you just are pretty sure that there's nothing in this stuff but a bunch of myth. Even if that is your experience this morning, I want you to consider it today. And even though you've had pain in your life, maybe you feel like, man, if God was a loving God, then there was that time where he would have stepped in, but he didn't step in, and so they died, or they left, or you went bankrupt, or you were hurt, and God didn't step in, therefore he must not exist. In spite of all of those things, I want you to just consider this morning to give your life to God. Why? I'll get to that in a little bit. First, enough about you guys. I want to talk about me. Really, I want to talk a little bit this morning about what a rough week I have had. It's just been a really crappy week. Any of you ever have those every once in a while where just the whole week is just crap? Sorry, can I say crap? It's the Wild Horse Theater. I can say crap. We're not sure. It's just crappy. It's been a real crappy week. Some of you will know that around 3 years ago, a little less than 3 years ago, I was diagnosed with stage 4 lymphoma. And the doctors misdiagnosed me a number of times. I was struggling with a ton of back pain. I didn't know what it was that was going on. And so I was going to the doctor over and over and over again. And eventually, finally, I got an MRI and they called me in. And the first thing they did was they apologized. They said, "We are so sorry." You don't want to hear that from a doctor when you go to the doctor. They're like, "We are so sorry. You have stage 4 lymphoma. You have 18 tumors in and along your spine, up around your aorta. The smallest one, the largest one is about the size of your fist, and it is currently eating into your vertebrae. We screwed up. We're so sorry." Anyways, to be honest, you can ask my wife, we were really glad to get the diagnosis. Because it had been years of confusion and unsurety. And now we actually thought that maybe we could fight it, because we knew what it was. And then, at the exact same time, we found out that a family friend of ours was diagnosed with the exact same cancer at the exact same time, stage 4 lymphoma. And so it was kind of cool because we could go through chemo treatments at the same time. Sometimes we would even be in adjacent chairs as we're getting the drugs pumped into us. And as many of you know, God did something really quite miraculous in me 4 months after starting treatments and before I began the next wave of treatment, where they were going to possibly look at a surgery and possibly look at doing some radiation in order to kill the thing in me. They said, "We've got the results of your CAT scan. Come on in." I went in, and this time they said the exact opposite of what they said the original time. They're like, "We have some phenomenal news. You are completely cancer-free." They used crazy words like miracle, and you don't hear that from doctors very often. And for the last 2.5 years, I've been completely cancer-free, pain-free. And our family friend didn't get the same phone call. The same treatment didn't work on him. The radiation didn't work. And then last weekend, our family friend died. Lost his battle with cancer. And I struggled a little bit with that this week. Why did I get a miracle and he didn't? Why did, I don't know, there was just this kind of like a little bit of guilt that set in, a little anger, a little frustration. Why did he die and I haven't yet? Why have I been given this gift of life and it was taken from him? And even though sometimes, I mean, man, I look at my life and sometimes I kind of feel like I'm wasting it. Like I'm frittering it away on stupid time wasters and not relishing each moment of my life. I guarantee you Vern's family would love just one more moment with him. That right now they just wish they could have one more moment with him. And yet so often, I take my family for granted. I take my friends and spending time with them for granted. I waste so many precious moments. Like, why do I do that? Life is so precious, isn't it? How many of you know that to be true this morning? And yet some of us just, we take it for granted, don't we? I sometimes wonder how Mary, the mother of Jesus, must have felt as they were crucifying her son, as they were nailing him to a tree. As you probably know, no sane person ever argues that Jesus never existed. No sane person ever argues that he wasn't crucified. Historians and other extra-biblical accounts absolutely prove that this is the case. And how awful must that have been for Mary to watch that? A few of us watched The Passion of the Christ last Friday night, and ever since it came out, I have this huge hate for that film. I hate it. And so I forced myself to watch it almost every single year. Every time I watch it, I cry, I become a blubbering mess, and every time I watch it, I'm both thankful that God made a way for us, and at the same time, I feel just a little bit of guilt because I recognize that it was my stupid choices that put him on that cross. It was my idiot mistakes, and every hammer on his hands was because of what it is that I did, and it was the only way that he could make a way, and it humbles me every time how much he loves us. Anyways, it was my son is 13 years old. It was the first time that he would watch the movie with us. And afterwards, he said something so profound that I'm actually going to put it up on the screen here. It's not very often that I get to be super proud, but I'm super proud. Actually, I lie. He's a pretty awesome kid. Both my kids. Anyways, enough about me. Let's talk about Alec. He said this. He said, Dad, I spend too much time doing what I want to do and not enough time becoming who I want to be. 13 years old. I thought about that. How true is that? We spend so much time doing what it is that we want to do that we spend very little time becoming who it is that we want to be. By watching that movie, Alexander realized something that each of us knows to be true, that we must be confronted with death in order to truly live. That only as we wrestle with our mortality do we truly begin to live. I think Jesus' disciples were probably struggling with their mortality when he told them this. He said, I tell you the truth, whoever hears my words and believes in him who sent me has eternal life. He will not be judged, but has already passed from death to life. And as you know, each and every one of us is terminally ill. Nobody's going to live forever. We're all scheduled for a dirt nap eventually. It's coming. Isn't it? Yeah, bring on the dirt nap. But even though we know that death death is inevitably going to come. How many of you hate talking about it? I don't know what it is. I was reading an article the other day in our society that was titled The Last Taboo, and it was all about the fact that in our society we can talk about almost anything. We can talk about sex, we can talk about legalizing marijuana, we can talk about homosexuality, we can talk about all sorts of different things. But you talk to somebody about death, things get awkward. In fact, you should try it. When you go home today, just invite a few people over to your house. They're coming anyways for Easter. And just kind of like throw it out there as a fun little conversation starter. Hey, let's talk about when you're going to die. It's like, things get awkward pretty quickly when we bring that up, isn't it? And I often ask myself, why is it that we don't like to talk about death? Probably because it scares us to death. We fear the unknown. And it's interesting to me that the very words that Jesus said when he arose from the grave on Easter Sunday over 2,000 years ago, he conquers the grave and he says, "Be not afraid." That's the very first thing that comes out of his mouth. He's like, "Hey, I'm back. Don't be scared about that. It's going to be okay." He says, "Don't be afraid. Whoever hears my words and believes in him who sent me, God, has eternal life. He's not going to be judged, but he's already passed from death to life." How many of you are totally interested in skipping that whole final judgment thing? Yeah. It's kind of like those college students who, like, you get to take a class and they're like, "Ah, you can just skip the final test. Don't worry about it. Just cruise through, skip the final, enjoy the course." And that's really what it is that Jesus said. "He who believes in me has passed from death to life." That as a believer, you're already experiencing eternal life. And that death is just a transfer for Christ followers, where you move on to greater things. Jesus says death for a believer is just a transition. So now that we no longer fear death anymore, I actually get to enjoy my life a whole lot more. I'm not afraid or nervous about what it is that's eventually going to happen. All of a sudden, I'm released to actually enjoy what it is that's happening around me right now a whole lot more. But how do you get that kind of confidence? Romans 10, verse 9 says, "If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved." Or Revelation 3, verse 20, which says, "Here I am, standing at the door and knocking. Anyone hears my voice and opens the door, man, I will come, I'll fellowship with him." Those two verses really kind of outline what it is that it means to be a Christian. A Christian is not somebody who goes to church, you guys. Man, sitting in church will make you a Christian about as much as sitting in a hen house will make you a chicken. And you're like, "Oh no, I was practically born in the church." Well, if you're born in a car, would that make you a spare tire? You say, "Well, I've joined the church. I've been going to church for years." Well, if you join the Lions Club, it doesn't make you a lion. A Christian is somebody who says, "Jesus is Lord." That he is number one. That he is the boss. He's the manager. He's the CEO. He is the leader of my life. He calls the shots. He leads me to do what it is that I should do, even when I don't want to do it. And that's what it is that it means to be a Christian. Jesus is just saying, I'm standing at the door of your life and I'm knocking. If you just open the door to me, I'll come in and I'll help you through this thing called life. And I'm not talking about religion, you guys. Good grief. I'm talking about relationship. You might be Catholic, you might be Protestant, you might be Jewish or Baptist or Buddhist or Mormon or Hindu or nothing at all. I'm not talking about a religion this morning. Religion is just humanity's attempt to get to God. But Easter is about Jesus' attempt to get to us. He said, "I came to give you life, life to the fullest." We get to experience a relationship that he always had created us for. Where he says, "I want to know you. I want to know you every day." So let me just summarize a few simple facts for you this morning. First of all, fact, God made the world. Look at the mountains outside these walls and tell me that that was just a fluke. Man, it was the best part of waiting in line, wasn't it? Just look at that phenomenal view that we have outside. Or do some research and spend it at night looking up at the stars and tell me that there wasn't some intentionality in that. Man, you guys, even the scientists recognize that it started from nothing. And nothing can't start nothing else. Therefore, something had to be there at the beginning to start the nothing into something. Scientists absolutely agree on that. They call it the Big Bang. We just know who banged the bang. That sounded awkward, didn't it? I choose to take that back right now. Well, you're following my drift, if nothing else, yeah? God made the world. In fact, God made you as well. That you are not an accident. You were not made by accident. I don't care what your parents told you. You're an accident. There's no such thing as unplanned children. God absolutely made you for a purpose. He saw you before you were even born, before he even put you on this earth. And he didn't put you just to take up space, to breathe, work, retire, and die. He made you for something special. Here's another fact. We've all made mistakes. Nobody's perfect. We've all blown it. We've all messed up. We've all sinned. We've all done what we know we shouldn't have done. I don't know many people who ever claim perfection. I fall short of my own standards, let alone God's standards. I don't please myself, much less God. Here's another fact. I need a Savior. I need somebody to save me from myself. Because I don't like who it is that I become when I'm not reliant on God. You may too. Here's the other fact. Jesus Christ is God. He came to earth 2,000 years ago to show us what it is that God is like. That he wanted to communicate to people, so he came as a person. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen God. I can relate to that. You know, I have a hard time sometimes relating to this deity in the sky, this airy fairy kind of gooey thing that I can't really see, but it's got to be there. But when I look to Jesus, and I read about how it is that he lived his life, I read about what it is that he did, how it is that he walked, how it is that he moved and breathed on this earth, I can identify with that. I can understand what it is that he taught. I can understand God. Here's another fact. Jesus Christ was crucified on the cross. Somehow he took on the penalty for everything that I have done. To let me know that I am loved. To let me know that he made a way for me to connect with God who is perfect by laying down his life, his perfect life, to pay for my stupid choices. He's interested in a relationship with me. I don't understand it all. Man, you guys, that's why it's called faith and not knowing. I don't understand it all. He's just interested in us walking in faith that is translated into trying to love him as best we can and try to love others as best we can. That's what he was about. Faith transferred into action on love. Just to say thank you. Not to earn our way in. We don't get to earn our way into heaven. It's not going to be a total of what it is that you did good and what it is that you did bad. And hopefully the scale tips in your favor. It's not going to be that. It's going to be, here's what you did which was good, and here's what you did which is bad. It's a lot heavier of a pile. Even if it's just one thing, it weighs everything else down. But God tips the scales in your favor. Because it's all about Jesus at the end. Here's another fact. He rose again to let us know that he's just the first of many. And that's why billions of people around the world today are celebrating Easter. Absolutely, you guys, a fact that he rose again. I mean, I don't want to talk about it too long because you guys are probably getting sick of sitting down. You can give your mom a little scooch right now if there's somebody around you and you feel like it's falling asleep. I'm okay with that. Just scooch. Let them know you're scooching. Sorry about that. Just realized I scooched in front of you there. See, the reason that one of the many reasons that I know Jesus rose from the dead is one, his brother James, his half-brother James, didn't want anything to do with Jesus prior to him actually dying and rising again. I don't really blame him, because if my brother came up to me and said, "Hey, I'm the Son of God," I'd be like, "You're crazy." And I think that's what it is that he did. But then something changed. There was a shift afterwards, and suddenly James was like absolutely convinced that his brother was the Son of God. Or the rest of the disciples, even, who were like, after Jesus was killed, they all like fled, they ran away, they hid. They're like, "Oh man, we're next, we're totally gonna die, it's gonna be terrible." And they hid in caves, and they cowered everywhere else, and they like ran away. And then something happened where now these guys are like boldly, loudly in the streets saying what it is that Jesus has done. To the point where they absolutely, 9 of the 10 of them died for their faith. Now, I know a lot of people who are willing to die for their beliefs. I know a lot of people who are willing to die for the truth. But I don't know many who would die for a lie. We're like, "Yeah, you're going to kill me, sure. But I just want to keep this lie going about Jesus rising from the dead. Go ahead, kill me." It's like, no. These guys believed it. Because they actually saw him. 500 other people actually saw him. They looked at the holes in his hands. He rose again from the dead as the first to show us that you need not fear. Death is just a transition for those who believe in me. Here's the other fact. I really do believe that Jesus is here this morning. There's just something in the air. There's a feeling. There is something going on, and he wants to know you. He knew you would be in this service this morning before you were even born. He loves you. He cares for you. He has a plan for your life. He brought you here today so that if you've never made this decision, actually make it today on Easter, the perfect day. We don't ever do anything to embarrass people at this church, scare you or make you uptight. God loves you just way too much for that. He loves you more than you'll ever know. But even before you thought about this today, he has been constantly thinking about you. Jesus Christ is alive today. His purpose for you is unchangeable. He wants you to experience a life that you were created for, something different than you've been living, something special, something unique. Where if you don't do what it is that we're put onto this earth to do, then nobody else will do it. I want you to experience life to the fullest. And maybe like Alec, you've just been so busy that you've been doing what it is that you want to do, but you haven't been becoming who it is that you want to be. Jesus knows who you want to be because he put that desire in you. Let him change you into that person. But you're going to need some starting over power to do that. Maybe this morning you're in the middle of a failure. Maybe it's a failed career, or a failing marriage, or a failing relationship, or maybe failing finances. Failure is never final unless you actually allow it to be. You're never a failure until you quit, and it's never too late to start over. Like we sang today, the Bible calls it being born again. Is this reincarnation that you're talking about? No, not that at all. It's just a fresh start. It is an opportunity to like clear the slate and begin new. And some of you are caught in a situation here this morning. Maybe you can't get out of it. Maybe you can't get on with it. It's frustrating. The good news is that his purpose is unchanging, and his power is available, and his promises that he's made to you are absolutely reliable. So grab a hold of them this morning. Promises to save you if you just trust him. I want to invite the band back up. I'm going to ask everybody, if you're willing, for the next little bit, whether you're still like arms crossed and don't believe in any of this, or whether you feel like there is something absolutely going on here this morning, I just want to ask everybody to close their eyes, whether you're praying or not. Just everybody close your eyes to respect everybody else in the room. For those of you just feeling a tug, I just want to ask you to talk to him right now in your heart. You don't have to say anything out loud. God absolutely knows your heart. He knows the very thoughts going across your mind right now because he made you. So what do you say? it doesn't matter what you say as much as it matters the attitude of your heart. You just kind of talk to him in your heart and say, God, I realize that I've made a lot of mistakes. That I've done things wrong, and I'm sure I've done things that have displeased you. But I'm here today to just ask forgiveness. Jesus, I believe that you're alive today. I don't understand it all, but as much as I know how, I've given my life to you. I know that you're standing at the door knocking. I can feel that you're drawing me. I want to believe in you. I want you to be number one in my life. I need your power. I need your promises. I need your purpose in my life as I move forward. Some of you, maybe you've been going to church for a long time, and you say, I'm not even sure if I am saved or not. I'm not even really sure what it is that my eternity is going to look like. Remember, we're not talking about religion. We're not talking about what it is that you do or don't do. You might be a church member. You might be a great person. But do you have a personal relationship with God? If that's you this morning and you're looking for something different than just say, Jesus, I'm not sure whether I'm saved or not, but I am asking you right now to save me. Not sure if I've ever made this commitment or not, but God, from this point on, I want you to be Lord of my life. I want to settle that today. There's no reason for any person in here this morning to go out of here with doubts about their eternity. All you have to do is just, as best as you can, muster up enough faith to say, I don't have it figured out, but I'm going to put my trust in you. Because if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you absolutely will be saved. Count on it. I didn't say it. Jesus did. Father God, I thank you for your word this morning. I thank you that you are alive today, Jesus Christ, and that can bring a hope in us. And the difference that it can make in our lives is something that I personally have experienced, and each person in here wants to experience. A life of abundant, a life of joy, a life of peace, a life of purpose. There is no better thing. We want that fulfillment, and we know that that comes from being in relationship with you. Thank you for what you did so many years ago. We accept it. Sing this song one last time that we sang at the very start. I'm hoping you're willing to join us in it. And then after that song, one of the great ways to thank God, like I said, it's not religion, is by putting yourself in a place of faith. And some of you have been handed this kid, and you've looked at that and you go, man, but you don't know how tight things are right now. You don't know what it is that things are like in my finances right now. You don't know how difficult things are right now. I want to challenge you. Make a step of faith where you don't know how it is that this is going to happen. But you want to put a little spark of hope in a little child miles away that says, I don't care what the world has told you about yourself. I love you. I am willing to put you first ahead of my needs, my wants, my desires. Up in faith and hope that you know that you're loved. Please do not walk out of here with that kid in your hand. You are his lifeline. You are her lifeline right now. If it isn't for you today, make sure it goes back on the table. We'll get it to somebody else. If it is for you today, if you feel like just that, man, maybe it is time for me to do something different.